Tonight's Presidential Symposium reviews the progress made in recent years in the study of the cognitive map. Immanuel Kant famously argued that space and time are pre-experiential abstractions that form the foundation for our experience of the world. One might wonder whether it is possible to bring these ethereal abstractions within the purview of experimental science. The answer, as you will see, is clearly yes. This foundation of our mental life has been brilliantly investigated at every level, from the neurobiological mechanisms that mediate it to the role that it plays in scientific communication. We have learned, to our great surprise, that this abstraction is evolutionarily primitive, as it is found even in insects. Hull would turn over in his grave. We are extraordinarily fortunate to have four world-famous researchers come together to conduct for us this review. Our first speaker is Edvard Moser. He and his collaborator, Maj-Britt Moser, won the Nobel Prize in Physiology in 2014 for their discovery of the grid cells. They shared the prize with John O'Keefe, who discovered the place cells in 1971. All three of them trained as both psychologists and neuroscientists. I mention that because the number of psychologists who've won Nobel Prizes is very small. The place cells, the grid cells, and the head direction cells, which were discovered by the physiologist James Ranke in 1984, are key elements of the neurobiological machinery that constructs the cognitive map. Moser is a member of the Royal Norwegian Society of Science and Letters, the Norwegian Academy of Sciences, and a foreign associate of the U.S. National Academy of Sciences. With Maj-Britt Moser, he is the founder and co-director of the Kosli Institute for Systems Neuroscience and Center for Neural Computation in Trondheim, Norway. Please join me in welcoming Edvard Moser.
Thank you, Randy, for the kind introduction, and also thank you for organizing this symposium. So I think that one reason why Randy actually chose this topic for this conference is that the cognitive map is one area where the border between psychology and physiology is clearly on the way to be broken. So I would like to start with a small movie that shows the complexity of the brain, and the complexity of the brain consists of the fact that a human brain has approximately 80-90 billion neurons, and each of those receive connections or are connected to approximately 10,000 other neurons, so that you can just imagine how many connections there are. And if you then know at the same time that all behavior is distributed among neurons all over the brain, thousands or even perhaps millions of neurons, and these communicate together, how can we then find the traces of activity that actually lead to behavior? It's a very, very difficult task. And when I started studying psychology some 30 years ago, this was not considered like a highly fruitful task, with a few exceptions. It was two pages in a textbook of 1,000 pages. Today, this is different, and I want to show you how work in a number of fields, but focusing on the cognitive map, has actually made it possible to try to understand one type of behavior by its neural elements. So the cognitive map is a concept that I think all of you know can be traced back to Edward Tolman, who was a professor at UC Berkeley, and in 1948 introduced the concept to explain behavior of rats when they performed in mazes. So you see examples of such mazes here. I do not want to go into details because this is probably familiar work to most of you. But I want to emphasize the fact that Tolman noticed that rats were able to use shortcuts and detours as they navigated from one place to another, instead of just following the same line of movement over and over again. And this was this was theoretically extremely important because it implied that you couldn't explain behavior just by long chains of stimuli and responses, as was quite common at that time. But he suggested then that instead one had to could understand behavior as maps of the environment, cognitive maps that contain both the space of the environment and also the experiences that were associated with places in the environment. However, Tolman, as you all know, met a lot of resistance. And one of the reasons is, of course, that at that time, those maps could not be related to anything physical. They were an abstraction, and it was absolutely not clear that this had any reference to anything that was going on in the brain. And the psychologist, the behaviorist at that time, naturally avoided to refer to hypothetical processes in the brain. They treated the brain as a black box for understandable reason, namely that there were neither concepts nor tools to investigate it. But things changed, and in the 1950s, then several groups started to record activity from neurons in animals that were alive and were awake and performing tasks. So, for example, visual tasks or other sensory tasks. And a few years later, in the 60s, then even more complicated behaviors were studied. And I want to emphasize then that in the late 1960s, John O'Keefe and Jonathan Dostrowski began recording activity from the hippocampus. They did not know what to expect there, or at least didn't expect there was anything related to a cognitive map. But what they found was the following. I'm now going to show you a movie. This is a rat. The rat is walking around in a square box. In that box, there are scattered crumbles of chocolate. Rats like chocolate very much, so they run around to pick up these chocolate pieces. What is it? Oh, good, just in time. Yes, so then I can play the movie. So rat runs around, and now we're going to listen to a single cell in the hippocampus of the rat's brain. And each time there is a sound, a pop, then the cell is discharging one action potential. And you will also see the location of the rat when the cell fires with red dots. So you can now hear and see that the cell is very active when the rat is up in the upper left corner. When it walks around in the rest of the box, the cell is completely silent. So in other words, this cell is active at one place in the environment, and for that reason, O'Keefe called the cell a place cell, and this is a place field. And can also be shown in color here. So red is high activity, blue is low activity. So O'Keefe found that actually many, or even it turned out most, of the hippocampal neurons had this property. They were place cells. And different neurons fired at different places, so that collectively, it seemed like they actually formed a map of the local environment, so that you could, out of the activity of many cells, you could actually tell immediately where the rat was in the environment. And for that reason, O'Keefe, together with Lynn Neidell, suggested that this was an implementation of the map that Tolman had suggested more than 20 years earlier. So, but as Randy said, this is an abstract concept. There are no place fields in the sensory inputs. This is something that the brain creates by itself. But how does it do it? At that time, one knew nothing about it. We don't know a lot today, but it is an extremely important question because it may tell us a lot about not only space, but actually about abstract concepts and cognition in general. So this motivated us when we started our own work, and this was 20 years later, after the discovery the discovery of place cells. So the question we started out with is, where does this signal come from? How is it generated? And what you see here is a rodent brain and the sausage-like structure that you see embedded under the neocortex is the hippocampus. Below, you see a transection through the hippocampus. And in brief, it shows a circuit through the hippocampus. It comes from the entorhinal cortex at the end, goes through various stages, including CA3 and CA1, and then goes back to the entorhinal cortex again. So the idea at that time in the mid-90s was that this loop was necessary for forming the place cells, and that much of this formation happened in the earlier stages of the loop. So what we did was then to block these earlier stages and then record activity from the later stage, namely CA1, to see if the place cell activity was disrupted. And this is the result. You can see activity here from 7 different cells. The color indicates the distribution of firing rates. And what you can see is that there's still place activity. They're still spatially active. They have their preferred firing locations, suggesting that perhaps this was not the way it was created, and perhaps it came from the outside. And where is outside? Well, outside is here. This is a rat brain seen from behind. This is the brainstem in the middle, and on the outer part here is the cortex, and the colored area here is the medial entorhinal cortex. The upper part is the medial entorhinal cortex, and that's an area that projects right into the area in hippocampus where the place cells had been discovered. So we went to that area, started to record there, and I'll show another movie now. There's no sound this time, but you'll see white dots whenever this single cell is active. So question is then, is this also a kind of place cell? No, that's apparently not the case, because as you move the rat walking around, you can see that the cell fires at many locations. So first it might seem a little bit disappointing, but when you look a little bit more, you will see that the activity is concentrated on certain blobs, certain areas where there's high activity. So there's many fields instead of one field, like in the hippocampal cell. And if you watch even more, you can see that there's some regularity in the distribution of these firing fields. The distance between each field is more or less the same. So to determine what kind of pattern this was, what we did was to extend the size of the environment. So what you now see is a very large environment, and very large in this case means 220 by 220 centimeters, which is a lot more than one used to test rats in at that time. But it's enough because this size allows us to see the pattern, what it is like. There's no doubt. And as you can see here, in gray, you see the path of the rat as it's walking around, and the black dots illustrate the locations where the cell was active. And you can easily see that there is a hexagonal pattern that repeats itself all over the space. I've helped you here in the left diagram by putting these red lines on top. So what you can see is that it's a hexagonal, or if you want, triangular pattern that is repeated all over the space, like a grid. And for that reason, we call these cells grid cells. And then it turned out that these cells, they are not only periodic within the environments, but it's also they have the same periodic pattern in any environment, any open environment where you test the animals. And not only that, two cells that fire in a similar way, similar orientation, for example, in one environment will also do it in the other one environment. So it's a very rigid map. It doesn't really need any visual inputs, for example. You can get this even in complete darkness. So all of this pointed to a type of cell that was very responsive to, especially to the movements of the animal, more than actually the visual inputs. So it, I could have said a lot more than that, but I will leave it with that. So it points to path integration as a major source of this pattern. So once having discovered these cells, then we asked, how are they distributed in the brain? Is there any topography of this map, or is it completely disorganized? And the first thing we asked about is what we call the face of the grid. The face means the XY location of each of the grid fields. So you can see three cells down here, three grid cells, one shown in green, one in blue, and one in red. And they illustrate cells that are recorded at the same place. So this is an illustration of that, four electrodes. Each of them are 17 micrometers thick, so very, very thin. And below you have cells. And then you can see here that different cells recorded at the same location are shifted in XY plane quite randomly. So that means that at any given location in space, you will have cells that cover all possible phases. But this is different from the scale of the grid, because if you ask how the scale is distributed, it is actually quite organized. So what you see here is a rat brain seen from the side, a sagittal section, and the red area is the medial entorhinal cortex. The top is up here, bottom is down here. And as you go from the top to the bottom, you can see that there is a progression from a small scale at the top to a large scale at the bottom. So at the top, the distance between these fields is approximately 30 to 40 centimeters, but at the bottom it can be several meters. So the scale simply gets bigger and bigger as you get down. However, this is not a continuous change. It is actually consists of discrete steps. And this is illustrated here in a recording which where we had approximately 50 cells. In other cells, in other recordings, we got almost 200. And if you have so many cells in the same rat, you can actually tell what is the pattern. So what this shows is on the x-axis is the distance from top to bottom. So top at 0, bottom at 50. On the y-axis, you have the size of the grid. That means the distance between the fields in the grid pattern. And each dot is one cell. You can then see that as you go from top to bottom, then gradually the scale gets larger and larger. You get more and more big grids, in a way, with a large distance between the fields. But what you also can see is that it is not a gradual shift. It actually goes in steps, and in this case, four steps. You can describe almost all of the variants by these four steps. And we call them modules, module 1, module 2, module 3, and module 4. And the funny thing here is that if you then ask what is the relationship between these modules, so divide module 2 by module 1, or module 3 by module 2, or divide module 4 by module 3, what is the scale change from one step to the other? Well, the answer is 1.42. So this is illustrated here. So as you go from small to large, on average, you just multiply by a fixed factor, 1.4 or 1.42 on average, and you get the next step. And you average by 1.42, you get the next, and then you get the next one by averaging by multiplying by 1.42 again. So this is, in other words, a geometric progression. So the brain is not disorganized at all. This is actually, it has turned out that people, this has caught the interest of theoretical physicists, and they have calculated that this is the most, the best way to organize grid cells if you want to represent space with a maximum resolution using a minimum number of cells. So these are the grid cells, but they're not only grid cells. So as Randy mentioned, there are also something called head direction cells, which were discovered by Jim Rank in 1985 and followed up by Taub. So the Jeff Taub. So these cells, if you just focus on the right diagram here, they have a firing rate that is related to the direction of the animal, of the animal's head. So when you can see firing rate as a function of direction here. So when the rat is looking to the left, it's high firing, otherwise no firing at all. Same here. And this cell, it is when the rat is looking upwards to the left on these both of these two trials, and then do not have any preferred location of firing, but they really discharge in relation to direction. And then, not only those exist there, there are also border cells, which we found a couple of years later. These are cells that fire only when the rat is along a border of the environment. So this is again the square box. This cell fires at the east corner, at the east wall, regardless of what the box looks like. If you stretch it this way or that way, it maintains firing at the east wall. If you put it in a different environment, it now chooses the west wall. Insert a wall, it fires along that wall too. So it shows that this is a specific type of cell. It's completely different from the grid cell that only, as far as we know, indicates the presence of borders, in local borders in the environment. And finally, last year, we found yet another type of cell. It's shown here. So first, from these diagrams, you will notice that they do not have any preferred firing location. But in the line diagrams here, for these 12 different cells, you can see the firing rate as a function of the speed of the animal. And you can see that each of these cells has a firing that increases linearly with speed. It's also illustrated in these examples down here, where you can see in gray, you see the speed of the animal, and in color, you see the firing rate for seven different cells. And look, for example, just at the yellow one, and you can see then that the firing rate very, very closely matches the speed, so that these cells is a distinct, yet another distinct type of cell that really monitors the speed of the cells. So you have grid cells, you have head direction cells, you have border cells, and you have speed cells. They're all intermingled in the adrenal circuit. And about the speed cells, they are very important. So we have been missing those. We have been looking for those for the very reason that if you want to do path integration, if you want to calculate your position from your own path, you need this instantaneous information about speed. And here they are. So you may wonder, are these cells present only in rats or mice? No, not at all. They exist also in bats. And why is that important? It's important because bats are on a completely different branch of the phylogenetic tree for mammals compared to rodents. And similar cells have been discovered in monkeys and also in humans, although they are different in some senses. But it seems then to suggest that this is the spatial system is wired up quite similarly in all mammals. So I'm approach the end, but there's one question I want to address, and that is, what is a grid cell like in a natural environment? You may wonder, and this is the psychologist question, so I always say, yes, rats don't only walk in boxes. So that's true, and this is more what the natural environment looks like. So we tried to simulate that in the lab by breaking the box into alleys with different, 10 different alleys. Actually, the rat walks in a zigzag pattern from one end to the other, and then asked, if the rat has to do this, and it's like a house with many rooms, do you still have an overall grid that covers the entire environment? And the answer is no. So this is just a control condition. It's open here at left and to the right. But in the middle, you see the zigzag pattern. And what you see is that the cell fires at exactly the same location along each of the track in each of the alleys. So the overall grid pattern is not there. But within each alley, you have a firing at a specific location. The way we interpreted that was that the grid is simply fragmented into pieces. And so when the rat makes a turn at a significant point in space, then it all begins over and over again. But then this is a specialized type of environment. So we then went back to the open field again and looked more closely at the grid pattern. And you see one example here. This looks like a hexagonal grid. But if you look more closely in the middle, you see the lines I've indicated here to illustrate the orientation of the grids. You see there's a breaking point along the diagonal in the middle. And that is also illustrated here, the grid cell I showed in the beginning. If you look more closely, the orientation is actually different in different parts. which we now know is because different parts of the grids are anchored to different parts of the wall or different walls of the environment. So the upper part is anchored mostly to the upper wall and the lower part mostly to the lower wall. So I think this is an illustration of what it is like in a real environment, in a larger environment, that you have many mini grids that sort of fuse together in ways we don't quite understand. We are working on that. If I had more time, I would say more about it. But I think this is the way it probably operates in environments that are more complex and larger than the boxes we used for most of the experiments. So for the final 2 minutes, I will do something that I consider extremely brave, namely to try to explain possible mechanisms of grid cells. I'll do that in 2 minutes. Of course, we don't know that because this is a lot of the, it's still much at the hypothesis stage. But there has been work based on ideas coming from physics that you can actually get these grid patterns and also place cell patterns, it was suggested, by what is called attractor networks. Networks where cells are strongly connected to each other. First, in the 90s, the idea started out with what you see in the upper part here is a network of place cells, and each dot is one place cell, and they're organized in this diagram according to where they fire. The idea is then that if you connect cells with a similar firing location with the red lines shown here, then and if you have an inhibitory surround here as well, what you get as a result is localized activity because the cells that fire in the same place all excite each other. And the surround, the inhibitory surround, prevents it from sort of exciting the whole thing. If you then add an input with speed and direction to this network, you can actually move this bump of activity around in accordance with where the rat is at any given time. So this was at the time of place cells, but how about grid cells? Well, you can get similar blobs of activity at many places in the network. And if that happens, if you get such self-exciting blobs of activity in the network at many places, and there's an inhibitory surround, what is a natural pattern into which this will stabilize? Well, like many patterns in many places in nature, it stabilizes into a hexagonal pattern. It's the pattern where the distance between the blobs is as large as it can be. And this has been the idea, and this has even been simulated. This just shows the result of a simulation in a computer where you have inhibitory surrounds around each cell. So each pixel in this map is one cell. They all have a ring of inhibition again around each other. It's just shown for two cells here, but actually it's the same for all of the cells. If you let that happen, the pattern self-organizes into a hexagonal pattern. And if you then add speed and direction, you can move it all around in accordance with the rat's position in the environment. So I don't expect you to explain, to understand this. There's no idea about that. But what I wanted to communicate here is that the field has developed to the point where you actually have ideas about how these patterns can arise and maybe how they even can be used for a rat to find its way in the environment. And that is a significant development because for most of other cognitive functions, we have no clue about how this still happens at the level of thousands of interacting neurons. But here, and this is then one of the fields where actually is such a development. So then coming to my last slide, I would just say, if I come back to the point where I started, that the cognitive map has developed enormously since it was proposed by Tolman, and that the whole idea has now been supported by concepts that actually have a physical or a neuronal substrate, and we have thoughts about how they interact to actually form both the patterns of activity, the map, and even the use of the map to go from one place to the other. So all of the work I presented is there are hundreds of people around, and many of them are shown here. So Randy mentioned Maybrit, Menno Witter has been important, many others, Bruce McNaughton, Carol Barnes. I can't mention them all, it's too much, but you have the names here, and lots of people have also paid for this. So I think I would stop there, and then let Randolph take over.
Neurobiologist whose work on learning and memory in the honeybee has okay, has great. We're moving from the rat to the honeybee here. Notice greatly advanced our understanding of the extraordinary capacities of this tiny brain. The honeybee brain has roughly the number of neurons that you would find in a single voxel of the fMRI scans that our next speaker, Russ, that is next after Randolph, will tell us about. So it is truly tiny. But as you will see, that little brain also makes maps. Randolph Menzel is a professor and head of the Institute of Neurobiology at the Freie Universität, the Free University of Berlin, where he has been since 1976. Menzel earned his PhD in 1967 from the University of Frankfurt for his work on color vision and learning processes in honeybee. Menzel chose the honeybee because the simplicity of bees' brain circuitry, in combination with their complex behaviors, which range from flying and swimming to nest building and communication, allows Menzel to track memory traces down to the individual neuron, enabling him to study the formation of memories in extraordinary detail. For example, he was able to identify the signal molecules and the reactions that make up the short and long-term memory storage process. Since these elementary processes are similar to those in human brains, these findings can be used as a model to better understand human memory. He seeks to deepen his understanding even further in his current research projects, which include investigations into honeybees' navigational, olfactory, and visual conditioning, as well as the role of sleep in their memory consolidations. Who knew that bees slept? Menzel has served as the president of the International Society of Neuroethology. He is an APS fellow, as well as a fellow of the Academy of Arts and Sciences Mainz, the Berlin Academy of Sciences, and the Royal Norwegian Academy of Sciences. Among his many honors and awards is the Carl Ritter von Frisch Prize from the German Zoological Society, and the 2007 International Prize of Cognitive Neuroscience from the Foundation FISEN in France. Please join me in welcoming Randolph Menzel.
So, thank you, Randy, for this nice introduction and for inviting me. It's a great pleasure to be here, and I hope even this tiny little brain might be able to contribute something to this topic of cognitive map. I think one of the most impressive achievements in behavioral biology of the last century was the discovery of the waggle dance by Carl von Frisch. Here in this old movie, he shows how to record and how to measure this kind of behavior, which is a rather strange form of walking and waggling in the dark hive on the vertical surface, and he could read the distance and direction of the outbound flight of the bee, which had been experiencing an important feeding place, and he found out that the animal converts the relative location to the azimuth of the sun into the angle of waggling relative to the gravity force. And he also found out that the speed with which the animal performs this movement is related to the distance. And distance is measured in insects by optic flow. So somehow the distance measured by the visual system is converted into a motor pattern in the darkness and codes the outbound flight to this particular location. Now, for Frisch, it was difficult to prove that the animals surrounding this dancing bee, the recruited animals, are indeed learning from the animal where to fly, in which direction and over which distance. Meanwhile, we can do it with using our radar system, and the bees carry such a little transponder. And now, using this technique in different environments, we can then follow and see how well they perform according to the instruction they received during this communication process. We do this in two different environments. In one case, we have a highly structured environment with a beacon which can be seen over about 100 meters from the distance. There is a panorama, there are local and extended landmarks on the ground. And there's another environment in which there is no beacon in the closer vicinity of the hive, at least outside of 30 meter distance. There is no structured panorama. There is no local extended, but there are local extended landmarks on the ground. Now, when you look at this, then you see this animal has been reporting vagal dance from this hive to the feeder over 200 meters flying to the north, to the east. And we took a recruited animal, transported it in the dark to this place, and it flew exactly this distance over the same in the direction. Then it returned, made a few turns, and searched around, and then it flew straight home. Now, when you look more carefully over the distribution of these flights of the recruited animals, then you see some of them may decide after being transported to an unexpected release site. Here's the hive, and here was the dance, and the dance bee was indicating this direction and distance, and we transported the animal to this place, and some of them decide to fly home because this is kind of different from what they expected, and then they fly, and there is quite some scatter, both in the directionality and in the distance flown, but overall, in an average, it matches very nicely, as you can see, for the distance and direction. And interestingly enough, if the dance encodes a farther distance, let's say 900 meters up to, we tested 2.4 kilometers, then the flight is very straight and very accurate, meaning that if the vagal phase lasts longer and if more of the vagals are performed, then the animals are more accurate in flying and following this instruction. Now, with this data, we can say Carl von Frisch indeed was correct by interpreting the vagal dance as an instruction of the surrounding animals, the recruited animals, the dance following animals to fly in a particular direction and distance. And we found also that the variance is related to the amount of information, particularly with respect to the number of vagals in the vagal run. And meanwhile, we know that indeed this is a discrete kind of distance code because each vagal codes for something like 60 meters. Now, this kind of dance communication happens only if the animals are familiar with the environment. And they do it, and I will show you how they do it, they explore the area. Now we ask the question, if it is necessary for them to understand what the dancing bee tells them, do they somehow use the memory they have established during exploration for following this instruction? And for that reason, we went into an environment which is a more rich environment with a lot of particular structures. And we had an animal dancing for something like 400 meters or so. And it flew over an even area of grassland. And then we took the recruited animals and release them either also in an even environment or at an extended, elongated ground structure, let's say a path or a gravel road, and which had the same direction. Asking the question whether the guidance by some extended lane structure makes they fly more accurate. And it turns out this is not the case. They are equally correct, or equal, the variance of the vector components of this flight is equally fine for both of the conditions. But if you then take a situation in which the dancing bee flew in its outbound flight along such extended landmark structure, again a gravel road, and the dance following bees were transported to two release sites, either following such a parallel extended landmark or crossing over such an evenly structured area, then it turns out that the vector flights of the recruits are less accurate if they expected such an extended landmark but didn't find it. So that they are equally accurate if they follow such a structure which the dancing bee had followed before, and they are less if there is a mismatch between what they expected and what they experienced when they fly out. So in this context, we might then ask, what is this kind of memory structure which they have established during their exploration? And when you look for this, then you find out that each animal, when it is a young animal, comes out of the colony the first time, then it performs a particular form of exploration, and that is being repeated several times, 4 to 6 times of exploratory orientation flights. And here I show you 10 different animals in different colors for their second orientation flight. And as you can see, some of them stay in the closer vicinity, the blue and the red and this one. Others are more exploratory, they go in a further distance, and others do even a double loop, so to say. And when you follow these single animals, the individuals over several repeated orientation flights, then you find that if such an animal has been exploring this sector, in the next flight it explores a different sector, and then the next flight a different sector. And there is a regular procedure of exploring the different directions and the different distances in consecutive kind of orientation flights. This means that somehow at the end of this exploration, they have established a form of memory about the landscape, and this memory structure then guides them in a way which allows them to follow the dance and also find new food sources themselves or new nest sites. We wanted to ask in the next experiment, what is the structure of this navigational memory? So for this reason, we take experienced animals. They had done their orientation flights, and they have maybe even already foraged at a particular location, and we train them from the hive to a feeder. And they do this many times in root flies. Then when an animal is ready to fly back, we catch it, put it in our pocket, and put a transponder on it and let it fly. And in this moment, we know already from earlier experience that the animal flies off in the same direction as if it would not have been transported to an unexpected release site. But what is at the end? What happens to this animal? Are they lost or do they find back home? Now I show you a situation in which such an animal which had been traveling forth and back over this distance of about 250 meters to the east, we transport it over here, it first flies in this direction, searches for a moment, and then flies straight home over a long distance. And remember, this was being done in the landscape B, which did not allow the animal to localize itself relative to the environment and relative to a panorama, for example. They could also not have used path integration because we transported them to this location. So they must have used something which guides them back to the hive. And so one can then say, okay, is it that they are able to come back from all kind of directions? Yes, this is true. They can come back from all directions with within the explored area, and so on. You could say maybe they have associated somehow the homing direction with a particular landmark structure in such a way that they have established an ecocentric reference system in which they have isolated vectors which guide them back home and which are kind of coupled to a particular kind of structure, and these vectors are related to the sun compass. Now, strangely enough, when we looked into this homing behavior, about a third of our animals did not fly directly home back. They took the way from after some searching, to fly first to the feeding station and then along the route back to the hive. So this means that they might have done some kind of triangulation, so a vector addition in which they must have done quite something sophisticated, because this one vector is home directed and this vector is in fact outbound. So they would have to change quite a bit of their motivation in recruiting this memory, and it all has to be connected to this kind of a sun compass. Now, is this really an appropriate kind of model for this behavior? So to ask whether it is connected to this, actually to the sun compass, we did the following experiments. We wanted to shift the Earth against the sun. So how can you do it? You can do it, for example, in our case, by anesthetizing animals for a long time, for 6 hours. Then the internal clock stops. And when they are anesthetized for such a long time, then they interpret the sun as having been standing still and not moving. And so when you test these animals, then after they have been trained along this line here over something like 400 or 500 meters to a feeding place, and you take them and you anesthetize them for 6 hours, and you compare their initial vector of flight, and then you see they shift by about 90 degrees, 15 degrees per hour. So the control bees fly in this direction, search only for a little bit, and then fly home straight. So they would have expected turn right and fly towards the sun. And these animals, they flew in the wrong direction, but in the accurate direction with respect to their own internal clock. And now the question is, what are they doing? Do they fly in the wrong direction? And this is not the case. They search not much more, but they take the way and they take about the same kind of flight distance and flight direction to find back, fly back home. That means also they had been time shifted and they have a totally disconnected relation between the associated vector relative to the sun. They are not misled. They find home equally well. And that must mean that somehow the homing procedure they are applying might be initially have been based on some form of a vector association with a particular kind of landmark structure when they were exploring this area, and another one for another. But after some kind of multiple experiences with multiple forms of landmarks and multiple vectors, they should have established their spatial memory, which is in fact a map, because it is disconnected or made independent of the tight coupling to the sun compass, and it is based on multiple places, and it is based on something in which there is a kind of a spatial relationship established between multiple locations, and the animal can choose which one of them they are taking as their goal for the particular conditions. Now, under these conditions, we thought, okay, they use this kind of navigational memory, but are they also using it for the dance communication? The experiment which I described to you before were done later, And so because we thought, okay, maybe there is something in which these two forms of spatial representation are disconnected. One, the dance communication is a kind of a vector-based thing. The other is something which is based on this kind of multiple relationships, spatial relationships between these environmental objects. So we then did an experiment in which we addressed the question, do they really perform novel shortcuts between a self-experienced location, a learned location, and a communicated location? In this particular situation, the animals have been trained to fly, for example, over 650 meters to a particular place here. Then we close this feeding place. They may have, they find out there is nothing anymore. They hang around in the hive. And there is not very much else to do because it's late in autumn or late in summer. And we have two animals flying to this place and they dance for that place. This is now just two animals and the feeding place is hidden in the grass. They cannot, we even can't see it and the bees wouldn't also not be able to see. So the only information they get is direction and distance through the dance. And we set up this experiment in a particular condition in which we tested two different distances, 650 meter and 300 meters, and we had the dance indicated location and the experienced location deviating by either 30 degrees as seen from the hive or 60 degrees as seen from the hive. And 60 degrees means equal-sided triangle. So if they would fly over this distance, for example, between these two locations, it would be the same distance as back to the hive. And I show you what such a representative situation is shown here, in which we have the 650 meter distance. The animal had been following a dance for more than 15 rounds, which stimulates it to fly according to the dance information. It comes to this location. There is nothing it can experience, and there is no particular landmark structure or anything. It flies over directly to this location. There's again nothing anymore. There is only the remembered location from the former foraging cycle. And then it flies home directly back to the hive. So indeed, they make a cross flight. It's a shortcut, cutting flight from a dance-indicated location to a self-experienced location. And when we look for these different conditions, then we find out in the case of a long distance, as shown here for the 650 meters, they do it only for a deviation of 60 degrees and not for, for 30 degrees, not for the 60 degrees. So one would argue the novel shortcut over here is avoided for a distance which equals the distance back to the hive, to the safe place. But in the condition of the 300 meters, they do it both for the 30 degrees and also for the 60 degree deviation. And that means they can make decisions about a novel shortcut, which indicates to us that the two locations are put into the same reference system, so to say they are available in the same kind of memory structure, the experienced one and also the dance indicated one. And that means that this is a strong indication for some form of a cognitive map, which is both used and used as a reference for the navigation and also for the communication process. So summing up, I would say this controversy between the kind of elementary forms of navigation in bees with this small brain and the cognitive level is usually seen as some kind of an alternative, but this is probably a wrong view. Certainly, the ecocentric forms like path integration used, for example, during the exploration early on in the foraging life of bees, then using also a beacon or making a matching of the location due to the panorama, all of that, and maybe also a far distance vector integration like triangulation, that is all fine. This is certainly something the bees would do, but in addition to that, beyond the ecocentric navigation and communication, there is this cognitive level, which under certain kind of conditions in which the animal has to search and recruit a full memory, so to say, then it can refer to something which establishes spatial relations in a multiple form in such a way that it makes it flight independent of the vector coupled to the sun compass, and makes it also independent from the direct instruction of the dance, and in fact may then use it as something like an instruction by the dance as an indication for a location rather than as a behavioral instruction for the outbound direction and distance. So I would conclude then that honeybee navigation and the dance communication includes a memory structure, which I would conceptualize as the cognitive map, very much in the sense of Tolman. And here are people who have been working with me for the last 20 years on these and other questions. I want to point particularly to this woman, Jacqueline Degen. She has been doing these exploratory flight studies, and this has been a particularly difficult and very rewarding kind of study, besides all the other people down here. And I thank you for your interest.
So geometry is the mathematical description of the spatial arrangement of sensible surfaces. Tolman's positing of a cognitive map was considered almost beyond the scientific pale in his time because it implied that such an abstraction was a foundation of even rodent behavior, let alone bee behavior. Our next speaker, Russell Epstein, discovered the geometric module in the human brain while doing postdoctoral research in Nancy Kanwisch's fMRI laboratory at MIT. The geometric module is a small region of the cortex tuned to the geometry of a spatial environment, regardless of the sensory properties of the surfaces that instantiate that geometry. Russell Epstein is now a professor in the Department of Psychology and the Center for Cognitive Neuroscience at the University of Pennsylvania. He earned his bachelor's degree in physics from the University of Chicago in 1991 and completed his PhD in applied mathematics at Harvard University in the next 5 years. Russ strives to understand how people orient to their surroundings and navigate through them, and what brain structures underlie these processes. His work builds on the research of the Mosers, O'Keefe, and Ronk on spatial brain networks in the brains of rats to examine the function of these networks in humans and how they change when learning to navigate in a new space. He uses functional magnetic resonance imaging, that's fMRI for short, to reveal how the human brain represents scenes, places, and events, and how it uses that representation to guide human action. Epstein is an APS fellow. He has co-authored more than 40 peer-reviewed articles that collectively have been cited almost 5,000 times. He has advised more than a dozen graduate students and postdoctoral fellows, and is a member of the leadership group for the NSF Spatial Intelligence and Learning Center, a multidisciplinary university research initiative pursuing a deeper understanding of spatial learning with a specific eye to informing educational practices. Please join me in welcoming Russell Epstein.
Hi, Thank you, Randy, and thank you for inviting me, and it's an honor to share the stage with these presenters. So all mobile organisms must solve the problem of spatial navigation, the problem of getting from point A to point B. So suppose I were at the Art Institute of Chicago, and I wanted to get back to the Sheraton in time for my talk. How do I plan a route that gets me there efficiently rather than wandering around in a random walk? Well, of course, there are many different ways to solve this problem, and one of the most powerful and flexible ways is to use this mental representation called a cognitive map, which is the topic of today's symposium. In its strongest form, a cognitive map involves assigning a coordinate frame to the environment. One can then represent one's current location, one's navigational goal, and other points of interest in that coordinate frame. And then route planning becomes a simple matter of vector calculation, at least ideally. Now, as you heard in Edward's talk, there are cells in the mammalian brain that seem to be involved in cognitive map-based navigation. Most famously, as Edward mentioned, in the early 70s, John O'Keefe and Jonathan Dostrovsky discovered cells in the rat hippocampus that fire when an animal is in a specific location in the world. They labeled these place cells because the firing of these cells or one of these cells seems to signify that the animal is in a specific place in the world. In a famous book in 1978, O'Keefe and Lynn Nadal hypothesized that these place cells might be the neural instantiation of the cognitive map. And of course, we now know, as we heard earlier, that in addition to place cells that fire in specific locations, we also have grid cells, each one of which fires in an array of locations that makes up a triangular lattice, and head direction cells, which fire when an animal is facing a specific direction. So together, these cells allow the animal to represent its current position and heading, and recent work suggests that they may also be used to plan a route to a different location, just as one could do with a real map. So that's all well and good. But to use a cognitive map, just having the map is not enough. So suppose we have this very smart rodent who has a cognitive map of Chicago in his hippocampus and entorhinal cortex. In order to use the map, he needs to know where he is on the map and which way he's facing. So let's say he's just come out of the subway and he's disoriented, or let's say he sort of lost track of his position while walking around Chicago, involved in a heated conversation with one of his rodent colleagues. So this probably happened to you one of these times. If that happens, what he has to do is look out at the world and say, because I am seeing this thing, I must be at this point on the map and I must be facing this direction. And the term that I will use for that ability is landmark-based navigation, which I will define as the use of perceptible features of the environment to determine your location and heading or orientation on a cognitive map. And what I want to do in the next 21 minutes is tell you a little bit about the neural and cognitive basis of landmark-based navigation using a mixture of data from humans and animals. In particular, I want to address three key elements of landmark-based navigation. First, how we align our cognitive maps to the world in order to recover our sense of direction if we get disoriented. Second, how as a key part of solving that problem, we need to represent our heading relative to local geometric features, this geometric module that Randy alluded to. And third, how we identify specific landmarks as unique entities with unique locations in the world. And before I get into it, I do want to acknowledge the people who did the work, my postdoc, Steve Marchetti, graduate students, Lindsay Vass, Josh Julian, and Alex Keenath, and my collaborator, Isabel Muzio. Okay, so let's start with this first bit. How do we align the cognitive map to the world? What I mean by that is, say, Mickey's looking out at the world, how does he understand the relationship between the egocentric axis of his body and the coordinate axes of his cognitive map? Well, in order to solve this problem, it would be useful to pay attention to features that are fixed to the terrestrial surface, or even better, the terrestrial surface itself. In fact, Randy has argued that it is this geometric information, what you might call the lay of the land, that is a key feature that controls for orientation, in part because of its durability. So he wrote back in 1990, "What does not change, barring a rare catastrophe like the eruption of Mount St. Helena, is a macroscopic shape of the animal's environment. A tree may fall or a boulder may tumble down, but none of these minor events alters the overall shape of the environment. So for example, this pastoral scene here might look very different in the winter with snow on the ground, but the arrangement of the hills and the slope of the ground will remain unchanged. Similarly, this indoor environment has probably seen better days, but although the wallpaper and carpeting may have been different from the way it was a few years ago, surely the arrangement of the walls, the windows, and the doorways are unchanged. So that makes that a powerful cue. So Randy based this argument not just on his great intuition, but also on behavioral data that he and Ken Chang collected back at the University of Pennsylvania in the mid-1980s. In a now classic paradigm, they would train an animal in a rectangular chamber, so this is a top-down view, and they would teach the animal that there is a reward, the animal in this case is a rat, I should mention, they would teach the animal that there's a reward in one of the corners. And then they would remove the animal from the chamber, take it out and sort of disorient it by spinning it around, and place it back in the chamber facing a random direction. And if you do this, you see a very interesting behavior on the part of the animal, and that is that the animal searches for the reward not only in the correct location, but about equally often in the diagonally opposite location, which is a geometrically equivalent location in the sense that both of these locations, the long wall is to your right, okay, if you're facing that location. And the animals will do this even if there is a non-geometric cue that could potentially disambiguate the situation. So for example, the striping on the wall. So that suggests that the animal's really using the geometric shape of the chamber to reorient itself. Now, this behavior has been observed in many different species, including human infants. And I should mention that there's been a long debate about what this means. Some people, such as Randy, have argued that this is evidence for an informationally encapsulated geometric module for spatial reorientation. Others actually disagree with the informational encapsulation claim. Now, since I am friendly with and respect all these scientists, I'm actually not going to take a stand on this debate. I will simply note that these data indicate that geometry is a very powerful cue for spatial reorientation, and everyone agrees with that statement. Okay. So what's the relationship? Oh, no, before I get to that, just here's some data that we collected recently. My collaborator Isabel Muzio and I collected recently in mice. Here you see a top-down view. Here you can see the mouse in the chamber. And here you see the percentage of searches in each corner. You can see the mouse searches quite often in the correct rewarded location, but about equally often in the diagonally opposite location, sort of replicating this classic result. Okay. So what's the relationship between this behavior and the cognitive map as supported by the place cells? Well, we hypothesize that if this is really evidence that geometry is being used to orient the place cells, that we should see that if we record it from the place cells. So that's what we did. We recorded from place cells in mice while they were performing this task. And just to give you a flavor of the data, here are place fields from one neuron in the hippocampus of the mouse on successive trials. So remember, the animal is disoriented between each trial. And what I think you can see here is that there are really two locations of this place field. On some trials, the place field is in the upper right. But on some trials, it's in the lower left. And that is, in fact, a 180-degree rotation of the place field around the axis of the chamber. If we look at the behavior of the animal. So these are the corners where the animal searches. The animal searches sometimes in the correct corner, sometimes in the diagonally opposite corner, thus making what we call a geometric error, and occasionally in one of the other corners. And the astute among you may have noticed that there's a relationship here between the behavior of the cell and the behavior of the animal, such that when the cell is aligned this way, or the place field is aligned this way, the animal searches in this corner. And when the place field is aligned this way, the animal searches in the diagonally opposite corner. Indeed, the relationship between the behavior of the cell and the cells and the behavior of the animal is so good that we could potentially use the location of the place field to predict the behavior of the animal. So let's say that this is the place field on one trial, and we can simply compare this to the place fields on other trials in which the animal searched in the correct corner, and other trials in which the animal searched in the diagonally opposite corner. And clearly, if you had to classify this, you would say probably the animal searched in the correct corner. In fact, that's what it did. And if we average data across all cells and all animals, we find that we can classify the behavior with about 80% accuracy. So what I think this is evidence of is this claim that geometry of the environment is being used to align the cognitive map. When the animal is placed back in the chamber after being disoriented, it looks out into the world, and it forms some representation of its heading relative to local geometry, and it then uses that to align its cognitive map. The cognitive map, of course, includes a representation of its goal, of the reward, and that is used to control the behavior. Now, of course, we've known since the 1980s that the geometry is important for controlling behavior, but I think this is the first time that it's been shown that geometry is used to align the hippocampal place map after disorientation. And if we think about what the equivalent might be in an environment that we're more familiar with, we might think about looking out at a visual scene and then representing our orientation relative to the local geometric features, which in this case would be the alignment of the street and the angle made by the facade of the building, and then using that to understand that, okay, I need to align the cognitive map this way, which means that I must be facing to the east. This, of course, brings up the question, where is this representation of our heading relative to local geometry? And that's the second part of my talk. Where is this represented in the brain? Well, in order to answer this question, we need to look at the extended network of regions involved in spatial navigation, not just the hippocampus and entorhinal cortex. So this is a meta-analysis of 24 neuroimaging studies in which humans were put in an fMRI scanner and performed some kind of navigational task. And what we see is that in such tasks, we get activation not just in the hippocampus and entorhinal cortex, but in a whole set of regions. Now, some of these are not surprising. The parietal lobe, we know, is involved in processing egocentric representations of space, but we also get these other regions, the retrosplenial and parahippocampal regions. Now, these regions are of special interest to me as somebody who comes from the visual perception world, because these are regions that we know respond very strongly when people look at visual scenes. So if we just show people pictures of city streets, landscapes, rooms, buildings, we find that we get activation in these areas that we've labeled the parahippocampal place area and the retrosplenial complex. So this means that these regions are good candidates for extracting navigationally relevant information from the visual environment, including potentially information about the geometric structure of the environment. I want to focus in particular on this retrosplenial region, because as you'll see, this region seems to be especially important for spatial reorientation. And you can see a hint at that even if you just look at the connectivity of this region. So this is a review paper from Kravitz and colleagues showing the anatomical connections in macaque monkey between the parietal lobe and the medial temporal lobe. And I've highlighted here the location of the putative homolog of the retrosplenial complex. And you can see that this region is ideally situated to mediate between the egocentric representations in the parietal lobe and allocentric representations in the medial temporal lobe, the hippocampus and entorhinal cortex. And indeed, if you look at what happens when this area is damaged, you get a deficit that seems to be in spatial reorientation. So this deficit has been labeled heading disorientation. So this is a case report from Eno and colleagues of a patient who suffered a stroke that hit this retrosplenial region. So I'll just read this report. On the evening of December 11, 2000, a 55-year-old right-handed man with a history of hypertension, who had been working as a taxicab driver in Kyoto City for 10 years, suddenly lost his knowledge of the route to his house while returning home from work. He could recognize buildings in the landscape and therefore understand where he was. But the landmarks that he recognized did not provoke directional information about any other places with respect to those landmarks. Consequently, he could not determine which direction to proceed to go home. And so what's fascinating about the syndrome is that the patient seems to have no trouble identifying the landmarks, and yet they don't provide directional information. He sees the landmarks, but he remains disoriented. He cannot use the visual environment to align his cognitive map. So we thought this was intriguing, and we wanted to use neuroimaging of normal non-brain damaged subjects to test this idea that the retrosplenial complex is the region of the human brain that represents your heading relative to local geometry and thus allows you to spatially reorient when you're disoriented. To do this, we needed to show two things. First, that this region represents your heading when you're trying to spatially reorient yourself. And second, that it codes the heading relative to local geometry. So, to this end, we designed a virtual environment that was optimized for looking at different headings. This is an overhead schematic of the environment. And the cover story here is that this is a park with four museums in it. And the critical feature here is that all of these museums have the same internal geometry. They're basically the same rectangle inside. But they're laid out in this cloverleaf fashion such that they're all facing different directions. So that means that if you're in this museum and you're facing away from the door, you're facing to what we might call the north. But if you leave that museum and go into this museum, facing away from the door is facing to the east. And as you'll see in a moment, this design will allow us to identify heading codes that are tied to local geometry. Okay, so just so you can see what the environment looks like at eye level, I'll show you a little movie. So here we are in the virtual park. You can see two of the museums here. You can see the museums are all visually distinct from each other. Here we're going to go into this third one, and you can see it's a big rectangle. And all the museums have the same shape rectangle, although they look visually different inside, so they can be distinguished. Now, of course, it wouldn't be a museum if you didn't have exhibits. So then you can see on the map that each of the museums has eight exhibits. So here's an example. This is a lamp. So they're not a very interesting museum. It's kind of like a museum of ordinary things. Four of them, as a matter of fact. Now, critically, as you can see, this exhibit is on this alcove. And the reason why that's important is because it means that to be facing the lamp, you're facing to the west, okay? That's gonna turn out to be important. Now, prior to putting people in the scanner, we taught them this environment. They had to learn the locations of the objects and the layout. And so by the time they go into the scanner, they have all this knowledge. Then we put them in the scanner and we ask them to retrieve this spatial knowledge. Here's how we do it. We give them what's called a judgment of relative direction task. And all this involves is that on each trial, they have to imagine facing one object, and then they have to say whether another object would be to the left or the right. So for example, on this trial here, facing the cake, they have to imagine that they are facing the cake, and then they have to say whether the bike would be to the left or the right there. And then the next trial, they have to imagine they're facing the lamp, and so on. So the critical aspect of this task is that it requires subjects to reinstantiate a spatial situation on each trial. That's like spatial reorientation. It's like you have to say, okay, now I'm here facing this direction. So that's akin to spatial reorientation. And I want to emphasize that the only stimuli that are shown are these words on the left. They don't see the map, they don't in the scanner, they don't see the scenes. So this really is about retrieval of spatial information. Okay. Now, how are we going to use fMRI to get just a little bit at some of the wonderful codes that Edouard showed you can get by actually recording from neurons? We can't stick an electrode in. These are just ordinary undergraduates. They'll do a lot for $50, but they won't do that. Okay. So we use a technique called multivoxel pattern analysis. This technique builds on the fact that the fMRI signal is collected in a bunch of individual units called voxels. So for example, if we zoom in here on RSC, we see that it might consist of 50 to 100 voxels. And that means that we can look at the activity pattern across all these voxels. So let's say, for example, that this is the activity pattern when the subject is imagining looking at view one. We can then compare that activity pattern to something else. So let's say this is the activity pattern when the subject is imagining looking at view two. For simplicity, I'll just represent these as one-dimensional vectors. Now, if the code here is really representing the imagined heading, you'll notice that even though the subject is imagining different objects here, they're imagining themselves facing the same direction, what you might call to the north. So if this is really a heading code, we would expect these patterns to be similar to each other. In contrast, if we compare the code for view one to the activity pattern for, say, view 3, which is facing a different direction, we would expect these patterns to be dissimilar from each other. And indeed, the data bear this out. So if we just compare views within the museum, we see that views facing the same direction give more similar activity patterns. So 1 and 2 have a similar activity pattern, which is different from the pattern from 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Okay. So that's good. It shows that this region is representing your imagined heading, but it doesn't tell us the reference frame that's being used. And there are a couple of possibilities here that just jump out at you. One is that the reference frame could be a global reference frame, right? So it could be that direction here, heading, is represented relative to the park. If this is the case, we'd expect views 1 and 2 in one museum to give a similar activity pattern to views 15 and 16 in the other museum, because both of them are facing to the north. That would be a heading code, but it wouldn't be tied to local geometry. The second possibility is that heading is coded relative to local geometry. In this case, views 1 and 2 would give a similar pattern to views 9 and 10 because both of them are facing away from the door, what you might call local north in the coordinate frame that's tied to the individual museums. If we look for global coding, we don't see any evidence for this, so we can cross this off. But if we look for local coding, coding relative to local geometry, we do see strong evidence for this. So to summarize what I think this shows us, first, I showed you that this region does seem to code heading during spatial reorientation. Second, these heading codes generalize across environments to have the same geometry, and as a consequence of that, we can conclude that heading is coded relative to local geometry. Okay, in fact, this geometry-based representation is so good that we can use it to reconstruct the space. So this is another way to look at the data. Here I'm showing you the similarity between the patterns elicited by all 8 views in this first museum. And you can see there's some structure here that some patterns are more similar than others. And to bring this structure out, I just perform multidimensional scaling and I'll plot the similarity between the views, the neural responses elicited by the views, against the map of the environment. And you can see that it's not perfect, but it's pretty good. So remember that all subjects are doing here are seeing words and imagining these views. So that means that what we're doing here is reconstructing the spatial structure of the environment from the contents of the human imagination. And the only scientific point I want to make about this is cool, okay? All right, so the last thing I want to tell you about is landmark identification. I've spent 18 years studying this, but I'm going to do it very quickly. Now, you'll notice that nothing I've talked about thus far has required you to identify individual landmarks. But clearly, it's important. So being able to recognize this as the Art Institute of Chicago might be important for saying where you are in Chicago. And if you're really lost, it might be important for bringing up the proper cognitive map in the first place. I didn't believe 18 years ago, but I believe now that this is actually the function of this region, the parahippocampal place area, which also responds strongly to scenes. And it's just some evidence for that. If we look at what happens when this region is damaged, we find that people have trouble identifying scenes and landmarks. So here's another case report of a patient who had damage to this region of the brain, and they reported that the patient complained of difficulties in recognizing previously well-known places or buildings. All the streets between the hospital and her home seemed unfamiliar to her. She no longer recognized the stores in her own street. In order to find her way about, she had to pay attention to verbal clues, such as inscriptions on store windows and street names. So notice that this is different from the syndrome we saw after retrosplenial damage. In that case, the person could recognize the landmarks, but couldn't use them for orientation. This person seems to be able to orient themselves as long as they can figure out what they're looking at. And although I don't have time to discuss it in much detail, I will mention that recent work in my lab using this multivoxel analysis method supports this idea that this region is involved in representing landmark identity. So for example, when we scan people and show them familiar landmarks, we find, and say this is the pattern for the Art Institute, we find that we'll get a similar pattern for a different view of the Art Institute and even the interior of the building, as long as the subject understands that all of these stimuli correspond to the same landmark with the same location in the world. Okay, just to summarize, what have I showed you? First, I showed you evidence that the cognitive map supported by place cells in the rodent hippocampus aligns to local geometry during spatial reorientation. Second, I showed you evidence that a different region of the brain, the retrosplenial complex, represents your orientation relative to local geometry. And third, I showed you evidence that this third region of the brain seems to represent the identity of individual landmarks. And those of you who notice the literature, of course, will be mindful that there are many things I've left out. So clearly, head direction cells and border cells are going to play an important part of this story. I didn't talk about them. But I believe that the results I show you allow us to begin to sketch out an overview of the neural systems for landmark-based navigation. And just to close, I'd like to sort of reiterate what we've heard before. I think this is a really exciting time to be studying spatial navigation. We can study it many different ways, looking at electrophysiological signals in rodents, looking at neuroimaging signals in humans, looking at the effects of brain damage, and looking at behavior in humans and animals. And I think we're really finally at the place where we can put all these strands of research together and really bridge the gap between psychology and neuroscience. Thank you.
Our final speaker is Barbara Tversky, the world's preeminent student of the role that the representation of space plays in everyday human cognition. Barbara Tversky is Professor Emerita of Psychology at Stanford University and a Professor of Psychology and Education at Teachers College, Columbia University. She earned her bachelor's degree in psychology from the University of Michigan in 1963, and 6 years later earned her PhD from the same institution. She has investigated the structure of spatial frameworks we use to locate objects in our immediate physical environment, as well as the role of spatial thinking in language, perception, and communication, and reciprocally, the manner in which these modalities influence spatial representations. Her work intersects with many domains, both in and outside of psychology. Her studies of how people visualize and communicate their own perceptions through through diagrams of caricatures or computer models has led to collaborations with computer scientists, geographers, artists, and filmmakers, as well as other psychologists. Barbara is the most collaborationist person I know and covers more topics than anyone else I know. Barbara Tversky is an APS Fellow and a Fellow of the Cognitive Science Society, the Society of Experimental Psychology, the Russell Sage Foundation, and the Eastern Psychological Association. She is a member of the Academy of Arts and Sciences. She was awarded the Excellence in Teaching Award from the Phi Beta Kappa in 1999. Tonight, she will review the many ways in which our judgments of spatial relations reveal aspects of our cognitive, social, and emotional lives. Please welcome Barbara Tversky.
Thank you, Randy. That's overwhelming, and thank you for inviting me. These are many hard acts to follow. We're about to go into the stratosphere. So one of my grandchildren, the last time I saw him, said to me, grandchildren say the best things, you're old. Much to the embarrassment of his parents, but he was right. And so I have a lot to tell you, and this is going to be an iceberg talk, just a tip, okay? And we'll run around a little bit. So people have, I think, extra layers to spatial thinking, to the ones that have been so beautifully conveyed until now. We do disembodied spatial thinking. Of course, it's based on embodied spatial thinking. And we ascribe enormous meaning to space. So I'll talk a little bit about each of these. So meaning, we use space to talk, to think, and to design. And the advantage of spatial thinking is it's more direct than verbal thinking, than language, which is arbitrarily related to meaning. Okay, long before there was language, there was space, and we've seen bees and rats and so forth. So spatial knowledge is special. It's accessed by many modalities, so it's supermodal. It's essential to survival. If we couldn't get food in our mouths and get home at night, we'd be in real trouble. It's the basis for other knowledge, and I'm going to maintain at least this disembodied spatial knowledge isn't really like geometry or physical measurement. So we inhabit many spaces, the space of the body, the space around the body, the space of exploration. I won't be able to talk about the former two, but I will talk about this one. And then there are the spaces we create. Maps, buildings, diagrams, and these all serve our own cognition and our physical well-being, and I'll get to those. So these spaces are conceived differently depending on our perception and interaction with them, and those the perception and the interaction determine our conceptions. Primary among them is us, okay? And our bodies have certain asymmetries of perception and action. We have a head-feet asymmetry, and we move upright for the most part, although I've been known to walk on my hands, but I don't do this as a habit. Front and back, we move forward for the most part, and we better look behind if we're moving backwards. Left and right have certain asymmetries, and they are important, but on the whole, they're more symmetric than either head and feet and front and back. The world has one major asymmetric axis, and that's gravity. So let's talk a minute, we'll use those facts about our disembodied judgments, and these are distortions in cognitive maps. So spatial thinking is inherently relational, and Russell told us about people that can't see the relations amongst things, and they're in real trouble. So in general, we think and talk about a particular stimulus, a landmark, say, relative to higher level structures and also entities at the same level. So we might say for a higher level structure, your keys are in your study. An entity at the same level, your keys are next to the computer, okay? So let's show how these, thinking about these higher level and same level, lead to certain distortions in this armchair, disembodied cognition. So first, larger level structures, hierarchical organization. Long ago, Stevens and Koop asked people sitting in San Diego, what's the direction between San Diego and Reno? And he had them draw on a compass rose what the direction was. The majority of students made a mistake, thinking that Reno was actually east of San Diego. So many of you probably thought the same thing. In fact, it's a question that's made it to Trivia's Pursuit. And the reason is that we can't remember all the directions of all the cities, so we make inferences. And we know that Nevada is east of California, so therefore all the cities in Nevada must be east of California. And of course it's wrong. Reno happens to be west of San Diego. So the hierarchical organization is influencing the inference. We did a study long ago asking people to put South America in a frame, a kindergarten sort of task, but for the most part, people uprighted South America relative to north, south, east, west. Again, an overriding frame of reference for South America. These phenomena work on blobs that aren't geographic entities. They work on kids and adults. They're pretty general, kind of gestalt organizing principles. So people also think that I've drawn blobs there for Stanford in the middle and for Berkeley up and for Santa Cruz below, and people upright the Bay Area. So they incorrectly think that Stanford is west of Berkeley, when actually Berkeley's west of Stanford, and they think that Santa Cruz on the coast is west of Stanford inland, and again, they're wrong because they upright the Bay Area in their minds. Okay, so now to ways that we use other entities at the same level to reference our spatial thinking. We gave people these maps, this pair of maps, Our apologies to Central America. It snakes through, and there was no way we could do this exercise with South America. It wasn't excised for political reasons. We're actually very fond of Central America. But the question really is about South America and North America. We asked people which map was correct, and a majority picked the incorrect map, in which South America is moved slightly westwards to be more under North America. Again, people make the same errors when we ask them about directions between cities. They make the same error for blobs and so forth. It's a kind of general organizing principle. This is an example that comes from Sadala's lab and from Tim McNamara's lab, and it's done routinely on college campuses all over the world. You ask people major landmarks and minor buildings, then you ask people, what's the distance from Jacques' house to the Eiffel Tower? And you ask another group of people, what's the distance from Eiffel Tower to Jacques' house? And it invariably happens that Jacques' house is closer to the Eiffel Tower than the Eiffel Tower to Jacques' house. Now, this defies any metric assumption, and you don't show people that they're contradictory. And there are many sorts of reasons that might be given for it, that the Eiffel Tower defines the neighborhood. You might say, I live near the Eiffel Tower. Unless somebody knew Jacques, you wouldn't say you live near Jacques' house. So there are all kinds of reasons. It also worked, and this is work of my husband long ago. It works for people think the son is more similar to the father than the father to the son. People think that North Korea is more similar to the then Communist China than Communist China to North Korea. So these asymmetries work in many ways, not just spatial. This is work of Keith Holyoake, and he showed that if you imagine yourself in California and you're asked to estimate the distances between San Francisco, Salt Lake, and Denver, and so forth, you think the distance between San Francisco and Salt Lake is relatively large, but if you imagine yourself in New York, then you think it's smaller. So if the perspective you take, the things that are close to your perspective, the distance between them loom larger than the things far away. Just as I'm looking out at you and the rows way at the end look one on top, they get telescoped one on top of each other. So perspective, again, affects our judgments. And these were discovered long before that by Steinberg. This is his view from his home on Lexington Avenue looking east, and here's his view looking west. Okay, so in judgments, we bring together whatever information seems relevant, in particular the overriding structures and the structure at the same level and then perspective. These are imprecise and perhaps incoherent. So we suggested that cognitive maps, at least the armchair ones, are more like cognitive collages. They're multimodal because they might be influenced by verbal information. And they're incoherent, but maybe more beautiful. Okay, these distortions are general. You find them in social cognition, in other cognitive judgments, in abstract judgments. And this suggests that abstract reasoning is founded in spatial reasoning. So this is, again, tip of the iceberg. There's lots to say on that, not for here. So now to meaning, since we've gotten there part way anyway. So place in space has meaning, direction in space has meaning. So direction up, down, central ideas, peripheral ideas, things that are near to us, things that are far to us. So all good things go up, and Dr. Seuss again knew this. He had Yertle to the turtle go as high as he could, right? Our gods are in the heaven. We talk about someone being top of the heap. There are good reasons for this. Fighting gravity, going against gravity, takes strength, power, age, health, resources. So we did one small study. It wasn't a small study. It was 1,400 people. That illustrated this. We looked at kids from 4 to adult. We looked at communities that read as we do, as most of the Western languages, left to right. We looked at communities, Arabic reading, Hebrew reading that go right to left. We had these kids place stickers to represent temporal concepts, quantitative concepts, and concepts of value, foods they liked, shows they liked, and so forth. On the whole, we found that quantity and preference go up. The things that you like, you put at the top. The things that are more, you put at the top, okay? Time tended to go horizontal, not always. Sometimes it went vertical, like calendars. It tended to go horizontal. Time tended to go with reading order. So reading order is a cultural influence on our horizontal, which is otherwise fairly neutral, except for left and right. And this guy in the second row can tell you about a lot about that. So now let's skip to elements in space. We have, and here, it's not so much the place in space or direction in space, it's elements that we put in space, and we're gonna see them in diagrams, and we're gonna see them in gesture, both of which are visual communications or spatial communications. So points on the whole can represent places. On sketch maps, they can also represent ideas and many other things. Lines can represent relations between dots, so routes between places, and relations between ideas and association maps. Arrows are asymmetric lines and can indicate asymmetric relations. Then we have containers, and they can represent sets or areas. So we get lines and dots when we ask people to make sketch maps, okay? And in fact, we've got a small set of a visual vocabulary that corresponds to the way people describe routes. And so there's a comparability there. And turns, they're not analog, they could be, right? But in maps, but in general, we make turns to be right angles, even when they're not. And we say the same thing, turn right, take a right, so forth. Sketch maps tend to make a distinction between curved paths and straight paths, and language does the same. You go down straight paths, you follow around curved paths. So there's a comparability here in the way they're represented, indicating that the same cognitive representation is generating both the visual elements and the verbal. So now we've gone lines and dots. Let's look at lines and boxes. This is work with Jeff Zaks. The work before was with Paul Lee. And we thought that bars are containers and that people would make inferences about bars that would be discrete comparisons because they say there are a bunch of A's and a bunch of B's and they're separate, okay? So we asked people, we gave people one of these graphs and asked them to interpret it. And when we got bars, we got discrete comparisons. When we made lines, we got trends. Lines say A and B are related on a single line. They have different values on the line. So we got trends for bars and trends for lines and discrete comparisons for boxes. And we did the reverse. If we gave people descriptions that were trends and asked them to produce a graph, they gave us lines. If we gave discrete comparisons, they gave us boxes. So boxes contain. So these elements have meanings that go back and forth between the depictions and the descriptions. Similarly with arrows, Julie Heiser and I gave people one of these diagrams and asked them to interpret them. They're car brakes, bike pumps, and a police system. Some of the people got a diagram without arrows, some got with arrows. When they got arrows, they gave a step-by-step functional causal description. When they had no arrows, they gave us the parts labeled, just the structure. So the arrows changed the meaning considerably. And again, we did the opposite. We gave some people descriptions of the structure of each of these systems or of the causality of each of these systems and asked them to make diagrams. And sure enough, when we gave structural descriptions, we got labeled diagrams. And when we gave functional descriptions, causal descriptions, we got arrows, right, with no label diagrams. So the arrow has a meaning that's shared. Okay, those are clear graphics for conveying clear systems, but echoing things that Steve Pinker said this morning about language, ambiguity can be useful too. So artists, designers like ambiguous sketches, and they make discoveries in their own sketches. When they're ambiguous, things emerge from the sketch. It's a conversation between the eye and the hand. And if you get artists talking, they can't draw anymore. It really is a nonverbal, it's a spatial kind of conversation that they have, and the language interferes. So that's, again, another tip of the iceberg. There's lots more to say about that. What if you don't have paper? So paper is a relatively new invention. We use it a lot to explain and understand, but it wasn't cheap until quite recently. So we carry with us things that communicate quite well with using space and things in it, namely our hands and our bodies. And we, along with many other people, have been studying how gesture works in communicating for others and for self. I'll give you one example of each. So this is a study done with Sukmin Kang, and we made two videos explaining how an engine works. The videos had the same language, but different gestures. One had action gestures, conveying the action of the pistons and so forth. The other had its structure, showing the shapes of the different parts. And we gave many tests of comprehension, and we didn't expect the structural gestures to make much of a difference, because previous work has shown that people, even low spatials, get structure quite well. What's hard is getting action of systems, and there are good reasons for that. So I'll just show you one of the dependent measures we use. We ask people to make diagrams of the engine, explaining how the engine worked. So the people that saw the structure gestures made diagrams like this. Again, they look familiar. The people that saw the action gestures made diagrams like this, right? So none of this is in the language. They heard the same language. And here they're showing you the action. They're showing you the gases in the carburetor, the things going up, lots of arrows. Here's another one. And they're showing you step by step. So just seeing those action gestures deepen their understanding of action quite a bit. Okay, I'm going to switch from gestures for others to gestures for self, again using space. This woman and the next woman is reading a description of a complicated space. There are 11 landmarks, and she needs to remember them because she's going to be tested on both questions taken from the text she's reading, but also inference questions taken from different points of view. So she's reading on a screen, and I hope this works. So watch her gestures. So dots and lines, and in fact, that's what we mostly coded, were dots and lines. Notice that she's not looking at her hands. Okay, I'm going to show you another one just so it's you can see another example. She was the only one that twisted. We hoped that we would get more of them because we had both route descriptions and survey, and we found differences, but okay, so she's mapping it out. So 70% of our people did that, okay? They didn't do it on every trial. Those who did it remembered better than those who didn't. Those who did it on those 70%, we separated the cases where they gestured from the cases where they didn't. They did better on the cases where they gestured. We've run another experiment where we had people sit on their hands. They perform worse, okay? So gestures for self upped both memory and inference. Students didn't look at their hands, so the representation seems to be spatial motor, an embodied one, not a visual one. We're planning a study with blind participants who are known to gesture. We'll see what happens. We're now replicating with, we did this with spatial descriptions. We're replicating with descriptions of events in time, of preferences and preference orderings and mechanical systems. And so far, our participants are gesturing for each of these situations, and it looks like it is affecting their memory for them. So that next year, okay. So I want to end I want to talk now about a concept, a word. It's a rather ugly word, but if someone has a better one, I'm open to it, that we've called spraction. It's a contraction of space, action, and abstraction. So actions in space can create abstractions, and I'm going to show you some in a minute. Those actions get abbreviated and turned into gestures which become communicative. The patterns that are created by the actions in the designed world and become incorporated into diagrams which instruct. And then we'll see the world as diagram. So this is the world that nature gives us, minus the asphalt. This is the world that we create. So we impose organizations on the world everywhere. We, our books and shelves, our products in supermarkets, and these express categories, hierarchies, and orders. We have bowls on one shelf, small ones, big ones. Plates on another, small ones, big ones. We're having hierarchies there in that information. So the world is giving us a huge amount of information. The rows here. We have lines for temporal order, and actually they go left to right in the US and right to left in Japan. We have one-to-one correspondences in table settings, repetitions, cycles, embeddings. Similarly in buildings, repetitions, symmetries, embeddings, one-to-one correspondences. An enormous amount of abstract information is there in the world for us and informing us. Okay, lines, this is the view out the window. Lines, rows, columns, stacks, and orders in three dimensions. So these get used, these same patterns get used by our actions in communicative diagrams. So these are tally bones that I think are 40,000 years old. And they're one line for each object. They're used for accounting, undoubtedly, so you can pay taxes. Abacuses, again, we're having one-to-one correspondences in the diagrams. Timetables, periodic table. We have boxes there for each of the elements, right? And the organization is really important. I mean, this is one of the most beautiful diagrams ever. So these get used in deliberately, again, in bar graphs. This is the likelihood of a computer issue being solved by reconfiguring something, reimaging antivirus software, uninstalling, turning it on and off. Okay. And this is another, how long it took me to draw and color each of these bars. But, so these, again, are used, these same bars that we created in the world are used in order to communicate these abstract ideas. I've already shown you how the actions get abbreviated into gestures to do the same. So finally, our world is diagram. There's a beautiful series of photographs of overviews of airports, right? And they're telling you where the supply trucks go, where the airplanes can go, where you can go. This is a view not far from my house. Tells me where I can walk, where buses can go, bike lanes, and so forth. So the world is diagrammed, and it's giving instructions on how we need to behave. Right? So thank you, and gratitude to the funding agencies. And this is...
So that concludes our program. I'd like to have a round of applause for our one, I think, awesome speakers. And I'd like to have a round of applause for the science of psychology. I think there's no... Thank you all for coming.